episode of Don't Blame Me is brought to you by Aptiv. Aptiv produces audio-based workouts created by certified personal trainers available through a mobile app. New members get 50% off an annual membership. Visit aptiv.com/blame. That's aptiv.com/blame.
Okay, everybody. Hello. Welcome back to Don't Blame Me. This is my podcast. My name is Meghan. It's an advice podcast. And guess who we have here to give you some wonderful advice? It's Jarrett Sleeper. Hey.
That's me. I'm Jarrett Sleeper. Hello. Hi.
Hello.
I'm very honored to be here.
Oh my God. I'm so honored for you to be here as I sit here looking very professional in my unicorn
t-shirt. You know, it looks good. I wish I love airbrushy t-shirts in general.
I know. I wore this and I was like, you know who's not going to judge me? Jarrett.
No, hell no.
And guess what you're wearing? Normal fucking clothes.
I feel bad because I almost wore my airbrush wolf t-shirt.
See? Is it from Mountain Artwear?
It is from a gas station on the 5
it's Mountain
somewhere.
Artwear. This one's from a gas station in Salt Lake City, Utah, and it's from Mountain Artwear. Big fan, Mountain Artwear. If you're listening, I would really love another package. I'm a huge fan.
Wow, that's
I wore this
amazing.
MTV Movie Awards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what you do. I feel like that's appropriate.
It's on brand.
It's just like, you know, in the zeitgeist.
It is.
Cool.
I'm a huge fan. And now it's trendy again, but I started it or we started it.
Aesthetic AF. Aesthetic with two C's. That's my new thing.
Where
at the end?
Oh, okay.
Like thick.
Oh, like thick.
Like I like to have a thick aesthetic.
But you have to throw a Q because I don't like thick with a K. I like thick with a Q. Like
oh yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Thick, like I Q U E.
Yeah, with a lot of H's.
Yeah.
Thick.
I definitely don't. I would never do thick with a K ever again.
No.
I'm thick with two C's these days.
Okay.
But I'm open to changing.
Open to
Q's.
The Q. Mm-hmm. Open to the Q. Q needs more love. Q's not getting a lot of a.
Yeah.
Not in a lot of words.
Q's and A's, what your podcast is about.
Oh, questions and answers. Wow, good segue.
Yeah, thank you.
That was impressive.
Yeah, I feel good about it.
Yeah, guys. So basically, if you're tuning in for the first time, how this podcast works is you guys call the phone number and you leave us voicemails telling us things that are happening in your life. And we give you some advice and try and do our best to help you out of these situations. And if you want to call and leave a voicemail, the phone number is 310-694-0976. Wow. I wrote it. First of all, guys, I just want to say that I wrote it down, but I wrote it down wrong and I corrected myself out loud.
That is like,
that's impressive.
Wow.
This sounds like I don't have ADHD. I'm curious.
I have ADHD.
Do you?
I just started medication.
Oh my God. It is fucking life changing.
It's life changing.
You're going to feel smart and you're going to be really pissed that you can't go back to high school.
It's going to make me emotional right now to talk about it. Like the first, because I put it off for a very long time.
Oh, hell yeah.
Seeing a psychiatrist. I saw a ton of therapists. I've done tons of meditation and various physical practice, whatever. My dad, I knew, had this prescription along with bipolar 2. I feel comfortable talking about my dad's mental health because he's my dad. And I hated what the drugs, in my perception, did to him. I think he's way overprescribed and it turned him into a different person. It freaked me out. So I avoided it forever.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized after going finally to see a psychiatrist, I had a therapist in the past recommend it. And I just said, no, this is why. This is not. Hilariously, no problem self-medicating with alcohol or marijuana that I got prescribed in California or whatever. No problem. But I wasn't about to do that. Great for other people. Always like, oh, yeah, totally. It's great. But not for me. And it was life-changing.
It's fucking life-changing.
I felt smart in a way I hadn't felt since I was a very small child when I felt like I'd have a thought and then I'd do a thing.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of it feeling like, I saw like a Bjork meme the other day where the quote from Bjork was like something like, just trying to communicate every day is like trying to fit an ocean through a straw.
Yes. Wow.
I was like,
true.
Yeah. Wow. And just that feeling that like everything inside your brain is like, just can't fit through this drain. It's like amazing. Maria Bamford wrote some great op-ed about falling in love recently. And she's had very public struggles where she talks about openly her mental health struggles. And in one of these little lines that really blew me away was she said like she felt like after she got through treatment, she would be lovable again. But she wrote lovable and right after lovable in parentheses, she wrote productive. And this like equation with like, what do you get done? What do you make? How productive are you? That's your worth, your lovability, that's everything. I attach these moral values to like my ability to get things done. Being able to go like, no, there's some leaky pipes that you've got in your weird body. Mm-hmm. And you think that they are who you are, but it's just your wiring, and some people's wiring works better or faster or cleaner, but has nothing to do with like yourself.
Yeah.
Anyway, if you have ever been, I think maybe because of the nature of the podcast, if anyone's listening who has thought about but avoided the psychiatry, hey,
yeah,
give it a shot.
In conjunction with a great therapist, I think it can be really good. I can't wait to hear you answer these or give some advice to people.
Sorry. Okay.
No, don't be sorry. You're doing what you're supposed to do. This is your job for the next however long.
Copy that.
Except I'm not paying you, by the way.
I appreciate that.
International callers, if you want to get our advice on your life predicaments, record a voice memo on your phone. You can email it to meghanpodcast@gmail.com and we will be able to play that on the air and give you advice. So we can take calls from the US and everywhere else in the world, but I'm not going to name more places because I went to alternative learning and my geography is not too solid. Okay, guys, Mel's here. Hey.
Hello.
How you doing?
I'm doing great.
Enjoying.
I'm very happy to be here with both of you guys.
I'm happy too. Should we get into the first call?
Let's go for it.
Woo! My name's I'm 24 years old. I have a little bit of problem with one of my best friends. So I moved away for about 8 months and then I came back and I only really had a couple of friends left when I came back. And one of them he's my best friend. He recently started dating this guy like 3 months ago. There's been a lot of problems with their relationship, like just like personal problems for each of them individually. Well, less than a month ago, they got engaged after only dating for a couple of months. And when they started dating, he kind of stopped talking to me, like stopped being as much as like a friend and wasn't there when I needed him. And I don't want to sound selfish, but like he's my only friend that I have. And so now he told me like a week ago, he accidentally dropped the bomb and told me that they were getting married within the next 2 months. And first of all, I'm not a huge fan of the boyfriend. And I'm just scared I'm going to completely lose my friend. We work together and we're really close with our boss. So me and her have talked about it and she totally feels the same way. Like he's completely changed. He's not who he used to be. And I just don't know what to do. I don't want to lose my best friend, but I'm not supportive of their relationship, let alone them getting married with only knowing each other for a few short months. I need your help. Thank you.
Self-containment, I think, is a common theme with a lot of these calls. When something bothers you so much about somebody else in their life, I think the important thing is to go, you know, look at your life and say, why? Clarifying the boundaries between where you end and other people begin. And not just, I think we always get that couched as respecting other people's boundaries and saying like, hey, that's not your life. But also more importantly, more self-care to me, understanding codependency, which I'm not saying this person is codependent at all, but that there are aspects of it that resonate with the codependency I've struggled with in the past, is when you have an intertwining, when this person is somehow imbued, you're imbuing them with power over your own life, your own well-being. This is my only friend.
Mm-hmm.
If they aren't here, part of my thing, what am I going to do?
Yeah.
You've already given away a lot of your power and put a lot of pressure on another being that is not okay. That's like not deserved or they can't be responsible for. So I think the first important thing that is really liberating for one's own self is figuring out why is it so important to me that this other person continues to have this role in my life. And especially, I think I'm thinking about the age a lot too. 24 is a real transition time in everyone's lives.
Right.
This is the perfect time to learn this lesson.
Yeah.
You know, when you're younger and life is more fragile, you know, I think sometimes we really do rely more on those close relationships and those kind of feelings of betrayal can be harder and to me a little more reasonable to try to avoid. But this is a really good time to say, okay, what if I'm just alone for a while? Mm-hmm. What would that be like? I spent a lot of time relatively alone right around that age. I had a long relationship, for a high school sweetheart, 16 to 24. Wow. We broke up right around then. It was really hard, really bad, didn't end well. And I'm not saying I handled it well. I think I went through a really dark period of time, but really profound growth and learning about these kind of ideas about like, how do I sustain my own psyche, my own well-being, whatever. So I think that is my first feeling.
Yeah.
I don't know. Do you want to?
I was gonna agree with. I agree with that. I think there's, especially when caller's saying that there's the fear of losing her friend, then also not liking this guy, and I wonder how much those are tied to each other, and if the feelings you have towards this boyfriend of your friend's is be. These negative feelings you have is because you're afraid you're going to lose your friend and you can kind of I mean, honestly, I can vilify anybody.
Absolutely.
And especially when it's someone that I feel is, I feel threatened by, like I've felt this way about like when my friends make new friends and I can, I can completely, which is a fucked up thing to do, but I can completely make them into these people and find and nitpick these things I fucking hate because they're taking my friend away from me or anything like that.
Well, and also I think that that's hand in hand with her, the thing that they said about, we both agree that they're, this person's not the same person anymore. That person's living their life. You have to be okay with that. And I would say, I've gone through periods of time where I believe I was the friend, where I was, you know, engaged, not being myself, quote unquote, and you know, whatever. I had to go through that time
to then become yourself,
to become myself, which might mean returning to who I was before, but that's, that's, you have to be okay with everybody having their individual journey. And anytime you feel that kind of fear around what somebody else living their life and doing their thing and making their choices and feeling that, that that's affecting you so deeply, I think you really got to take a moment to have some Zen conversations with yourself about your attachments and why. And you know, I always think of it like, I heard this great thing once in a documentary, I think maybe about like a woman who worked with like troubled youths or something like that. And this, this kid who with an aggression problem, they said to him, like, he said to the, his counselor, like, sometimes these other people, they just push my buttons. And the counselor stopped the kid and was like, what, they push what? And he goes, my buttons. And they're like, yeah, your buttons. And it's up to you if you like let other people come in and press your buttons. Like, we have that choice to like, they're your buttons.
Yeah.
So if this person's making, if it's making you feel a bad way that they're going to go away or do something, just when they're living their life and their truth moment to moment, even if you think it's not their truth, doesn't matter. You gotta just take that time. It's, growing up sucks sometimes.
Oh, it God, hurts, yeah. And you, you can't really interfere. As you can't really interfere, I think, unless someone's being put in physical danger, you can't really interfere with someone else's journey, because if anything, it's just going to fucking backfire on you.
Totally.
And the amount of friends that I've had who haven't liked someone that I've dated, those friendships, we went through periods of being like, well, no, I'm going to choose this relationship over this friendship, but that wasn't permanent. Those friendships I have with those people, they were rekindled. So I think my overall advice to you would, I think if your friend's happy, I think put that into perspective. And as much as you want, you have this idea of your friend and when they're being the most themselves, especially because you're away for a while and you came back and he had this new relationship, you might not know so much about this relationship or their relationship in general. I know it took fucking forever for my boyfriend to open up to my friends. And now finally, after a year, they're like, oh, I fully fucking understand why you're together. This completely makes sense. I'm like, well, yeah, because you're not, you don't live here and you don't see us on a day-to-day kind of basis. So I think if you can just be happy for him as long as he's happy and not, I mean, and if you, like, not to be like the worst case scenario thing, but I mean, maybe they won't fucking end up together. Maybe like this, there will be some demise, but I think the best thing you can do as a friend is to kind of, as long as he's safe and like emotionally and physically, if you can just still be by his side and be able to be that friend he can open up to and be that confidant, if something ends up going south, you can be there to talk it out with him and he's not going to like just bottle all of that up so you don't tell you and I told you, like it's not that I told you so kind of thing. You'll be good. Got faith in you.
Yeah.
Okay, on to the next call.
Hi, Meghan. I am 20 years old and I am a sophomore in college and I'm dealing with the stress of four exams and a final. And a very long paper. And I was wondering if you had any ideas on A, how to handle stress when in college, and B, kind of like fitting a workout routine into a crazy schedule because I need relief stress and I need a workout plan to relieve stress. And that would be great because I'm swimming up to my eyeballs in stress.
Did you go to college?
Nope.
Nope, me neither. I mean,
you went for a little bit.
I did.
I went a little bit.
Okay, cool. So we both combined might have not a full degree, but enough that we could have completed general education. Maybe something like that.
I don't know.
You deal with stress. I think we all deal
with stress. By being like sort of this weird, whatever this world is, this freelancer, permalancer, gig economy thing, stresses like. Just breakfast.
No, it's insane. And one of my best friends was just here in town this weekend. She's 22 and she's going into, I'm not going to name by names because she'll be fucking killing me when I actually say the story. She's going into her final for a general education course with a D-, and she has to maintain the D- in order to pass.
Dang.
And it was just crazy to me to see her fully within the span of like 30 seconds hysterically break down over this grade. And it was her sister and I sitting there with her being like, I fucking wish I could tell you that this kind of stress that you're dealing with is going to leave once you're out of college, but it's not. Well, so what's more important for us, we were saying to her, is like, we need to deal with how stressed you are about this. It's not about the fucking test.
I think that's so true.
It was so much more about the fact that I'm like, you right now losing your absolute mind and feeling so fucking terrible.
Yeah.
That's the bigger issue. It's not about whatever grade you get in biology.
Right. And I think that's actually a good thing to keep in perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. One, finite. Mm-hmm. Like this time will pass. And in retrospect, I don't think any of this is going to matter. If you get a degree, you got the degree. And I don't know how much that degree even matters anymore.
Yeah. It doesn't.
It doesn't.
Good to know.
Right.
Yeah. So, take it easy on yourself.
Mm-hmm.
We should go into like those stress management tactics that you, what do you do?
I would say, I think this is something that I wish that I had learned earlier on. I think I learned how to be anxious and how to be stressed really, really early before I learned that I was being anxious and I was being stressed and that those were things I needed. Those weren't, they're totally normal, typical things, but they aren't something that I'm going to grow out of or are going to get better by ignoring them. And I wish.
Also, I would say understanding stress and anxiety as a chemical response in your brain. Feelings aren't facts.
Yeah.
Feelings aren't reality. So dealing with understanding that they're manageable and that you just use some goddamn stratagems and you can handle it.
Yeah.
And that like whatever you're going through and you're like, oh, how am I going to get all this done is that's just a thing that's not helped by your brain. I was think of my good bad brain. Like I'm grateful to for all the things, but it definitely fucks me over a lot of time too. So lists, I like lists.
Yes, I was going to say, so post-it notes are like the greatest thing ever. I think post-it notes, lists for everything. I do lists on my phone, even now, where it's just like a to-do list of everything I need to get accomplished. And then I set alarms on my phone for those things.
Yeah.
I think time management.
Yeah.
You're also talking to two people who have ADHD.
Real bad. So we had to figure some stuff out though.
Yeah, but I think time management too, I think is the biggest component of what would contribute the most to stress for me is feeling like, I had this world of these things to do and there wasn't enough hours in the day, which some fucking days that's true.
That's true.
But I think if you can write everything down that you need to do and you can prioritize it in order of importance and how long it's going to take you and stick to a schedule and then also give yourself breaks.
Enforce the breaks.
Yeah. And not beat yourself up for this because no matter how fucking calm, cool and collected everybody else might seem, they're all losing their shit.
Losing their fucking shit. Mm-hmm. Lists are great. My friend gave me a really fun thing that she does with lists that I started doing if I do lists, which is at the end of it, you just write, make a list so you can check it off right away.
I do that too.
You do?
Yeah.
It's nice, right? Because you feel like you're functioning. And then don't feel bad. The list is just a tool. So if you spiral out of control and list an impossible amount of things, don't feel bad if you don't finish them all. Just start over again tomorrow, whatever. And the exercise I will say is really important. Your body, it's just like a dog, man. If a dog, there's not really bad dogs. There's just like unexercised dogs. I do have a tip for tight schedule exercising. I use it all the time. There's a protocol, an exercise called Tabatas.
I stalk yours on Instagram when you post them.
Thank you.
It's very fast. You're a machine.
I try. But like Tabatas are, the basic Tabata is 4 minutes. It's 8 intervals of 20 seconds of work followed by 10 seconds of rest. And the 20 seconds of work, you can do it one of two ways. You can either try to like hit a certain amount of reps on a movement. Like I'm going to do 10 pushups in every working thing till the end of this. Or I think the better way to do it, if you have a limited amount of time and you're just trying to like get that workout when you don't have time to work out, you go balls to the wall for the 20 seconds as hard as you can. Pick a movement, pick a full body movement. I would suggest like squats or lunges or burpees. And for those that full 8 intervals, you do 20 seconds as hard as you can. You do burpees and then you rest for 10 seconds and then go as hard as you can for 20 more and then rest for 10 seconds. It's really miserable. You will not believe how tired your body feels after just working your ass off for 20 and on 10 off for 4 minutes. That's all it takes, 4 minutes. But it totally works. And you can string a bunch of them together if you want, like do one that's push-ups, the next one's sit-ups, the next one's whatever. And those will turn into very challenging workouts. But that is my go-to. I have no time. Mm-hmm. I have literally 10 minutes. I got to get in the shower. I'll do 2 Tabatas back-to-back of squats and push-ups or burpees or something like that. I highly recommend. Yeah. T-A-B-A-T-A. Just use the timer on your phone, or you can download Tabata timers, or you can go on YouTube and look up Tabata timers.
Yeah.
There's
a ton. If you look on Pinterest, there's a ton of like, they'll give you different ideas for those kinds of workouts.
Yeah.
But I would also say, I think a huge theme, I always was like a physical person. Like I grew up dancing, I grew up doing all that stuff, but it was only in the last like almost year-ish, probably like 8-9 months that I've gotten very into exercise. And it's the most that I've been in control of my anxiety and stress. And I think what I would also say is people can get really stressed about working out because they need to work out because mm-hmm. it'll make them feel less stressed. And I think you need to be easy on yourself. And also there's these, mm-hmm. it's this system that we have when it comes to exercise. And I don't know if it's just in LA, but it's like, oh, I'm going to go take a Pilates class. And this is very me, or I'm going to go take SoulCycle. But if I don't have that, all of that's going to take so much time. So then I can't do that.
Nah.
So I think if you can look at it as a day-to-day kind of beast of maybe you have 10 minutes here, you can do a 10 minute workout here, you have another 20 minutes here, you can do 20 minutes there, and by the time you finished your day, you've added up to have gotten enough physical movements and exercise. And there might be other days where you have an hour to go do something, but if you're open to kind of the ebb and flow of making sure that the workout works with your life, but mm-hmm. it's not this one strict thing, and if you can't fit that in, then it doesn't matter and it's not worth doing it at all.
You know, like take the mystery out of
it.
Just move.
Yeah,
just
it's
move.
Not as just complicated move. As everyone else makes it out to be. And
you can pick up heavy things. Small. You can start small, mm-hmm. whatever. Get a jump rope. Don't even get a jump rope. Just jump around. Who cares?
Yeah.
It's easy.
Turn on some music, jump around.
And keep in mind, stress and anxiety, those chemicals are your brain's best efforts at helping you. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean they're right. They're just chemicals in your brain that are trying to help you. So be like, thank you, body. Thank you for the anxiety and stress. I know I got things to get done. And I'm going to take a couple steps. Lists, timers. That's it. It's easy.
Yeah, you'll get this.
Breathe.
You'll graduate. You mean you've made it farther than both of us. So you're doing good.
Yeah.
On to the next one.
Hi, Meghan. I'm 23 years old, and I've been in a relationship for 2.5 years with a female. This is both of our first same-sex relationship and both of our first long-term relationship. We used to have sex pretty often, enough that I wasn't thinking about the frequency, but for a year now, the amount of sex has certainly decreased, first to a few times a month, then to about once a month, and now sometimes we even go more than a month without sex. I've been open about speaking about the situation with my partner, as I would like to be having sex more often. And we're both very affectionate with each other. We're vocal about how much we love each other and having found the one in each other. And she said she isn't sure why sex now makes her nervous, and she feels almost like she's doing something she's not supposed to. She enjoys finishing and doesn't want to feel this way, but we tend to just mutually masturbate when we are having sex, and oral pleasure is far and few between. I would like us to get back to the place that we had been in once, where we were experimenting, having fun, having sex often. I miss the connection, and I would really appreciate any advice you can give. Thank you.
So it's not easy.
No. Shit.
Yeah, it's not easy.
Okay,
I would say one, the first thing I want to say, because of something you said near the end of the call, I know that I think the core concept here is about shame, right? Is like shame around, because even approaching your partner about this, like there's all this inherent, there's this cultural shame about being like, like you're something's wrong with you for being too horny or something like
no,
that.
No, yeah, it's like this, like, you know? This female thing of being like, I shouldn't want this as much.
Like you said at the end, that feeling that you want, that feeling of connection to your partner, and that can be very difficult if you feel like you want more physical connection that is about so much. It's just about more than nothing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's more than like, I just got to get off. That's very challenging. So I think, first of all, like, let it be okay that this is not easy.
No, yeah.
And you know, this is a legit thing to talk about.
Yeah. And I think my first question would be, because I mean, she's saying that her partner's saying she's not sure why she's feeling like this.
Right.
And she's, but the nervous and feeling like this, she's not supposed to be doing something like that after you guys have been together for 2 years. I guess one of my questions would be trying to figure out what's shifted and like if there's been a kind of change. I mean, my first thing is, just because she's saying that she's nervous and it's something not supposed to, it kind of eliminates what my original question was going to be, is if she had recently gone on any different medication, if she had gone on antidepressants, which can like totally ruin your
life
sex
changes,
drive.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of what I was going to say. But if it comes from,
but like life changes too, like, you know, family stuff, work stuff, like things happen.
Things that aren't necessarily medically induced.
To be honest, like
the political climate.
Dude, that's real.
I
think I'm grateful. I think after 30, since like 31 or something like that, I'm like, I can't even tell you how delighted I am that like my horniness has just decreased. I picture it in my head, horny, H-O-R-N-Y-E-S-S-E, horniness. Like the horniness. Because it is very challenging when the chemicals are just like, I'm 22. And that's mixed in with your emotions and your connections. I mean, communication, patience are like going to be the biggest important things. You got to just keep talking to your partner and do it in a way that's like no presh about like to try to understand those feelings. A relationship is much more than your sexual connection, like a million times more.
And my question is, they're still physical with each other in like a
affectionate
way.
Affectionate. Like a casual.
So I'm also curious what at what point does where does she feel nervous? After what level of like physical, I don't know, like any of that affection? Like what
well, she said
point,
this was the only same-sex relationship that they both had.
That they both been in. But
they've
been
she's starting to feel
2 years and then starting to feel. So
and they're still mutually masturbating.
Yeah.
Like around each other.
Mm-hmm. I wonder.
Around, which means just themselves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In the same room or near each other.
Yeah, which
I mean,
I wonder, I mean, there's also, I wonder how, if you guys can have a conversation with her and if she's open to, I think there just needs to be, which I mean, women are great at this in kind of breaking down each other's walls and that kind of shame, because I think you probably both feel this. Mm-hmm. You feel like you're like, am I asking for too much? Am I being
there,
too,
am I
expecting too much out of this? And am I objectifying this person that I love because I really need this physical connection, which by the way, you're not. And then your partner, she might be like, am I disappointing you? Am I no longer all of this? And am I no longer living up to the person that I had been before? And I think both of you just need to be super fucking honest and admit the awkwardness and the shame that you both might feel with this and figure out what it derives from. Because I think there needs to be an open line of communication, because I don't know if she's open to figuring out why she's feeling like this. Maybe she knows why she's feeling this and feels awkward and embarrassed, doesn't want to tell you. I think.
Yeah. I mean, bodies too are like a very mysterious blend of like psyche and chemicals and whatever. And pressure, nothing destroys libido more than pressure. And I'm saying this as a man. I'm saying this recognizing it in female partners and friends. Like, if you feel like you've got to be something for someone else, oh boy, nothing's happening. I mean, she said this one line in the phone call where she said, I mean, we know that we're each other's one.
Yeah.
And just kind of threw that away. There's a lot loaded in that statement as a 22-year-old saying like, I mean, we know we're each other's one. And for some reason that keeps popping back in my mind as something to maybe think about and say like, if you're 2 years in, it's the first same-sex relationship you ever had, and you know that you're each other's one. I remember being in this relationship when I was 22, right? And I was 6 years in with this, right? Something like that with my, yeah, my one. And I remember the first time noticing another woman. I thought, because my ideas about monogamy and true love and these things when I was like 16, Romeo and Juliet, which is the fucking stupidest shit ever, right? Like something that ends in like a mutual suicide pact after 3 days.
Right.
Is not a good example for real love. I remember being like, oh, this is, if I even was attracted to somebody else, clearly I'm a fraud. Clearly my love is fake. I just drew these weird pressures in my head. And I remember being like, the first time I noticed a woman even on the street, another that I was attracted to, and double taking with myself and going, what just happened? And having this like crisis of like, who am I? So if you're 22 and you're having weird things, like, I don't feel as aroused or as attracted. I feel weird feelings of shame. Like, maybe I'm not supposed to do this now. Like, you can vortex yourself into like really a lot of guilt and like, yeah, self-destructive behavior that'll only make it worse. It needs to be okay that whatever's going on is going on. And that's so much pressure to be 22 and be someone's only other significant other and know that they love you and know that you love them. I still like to hug them and kiss them and be affectionate. I love this person. But maybe that person's thinking, not saying that's what's happening here, but it's possible this other person could be like, I don't know if I want to be, yeah, with this only one person, mm-hmm, the only woman, mm-hmm, who I've ever been with, but I don't want to hurt their feelings and I do love them. Like, maybe there's deeper conversations to be had.
Yeah. That, I think,
you know,
that it needs, there's no, I think it's highly unlikely that this boils down to just sex and that.
It's impossible. Yeah. I'm going to say right now,
so
that
that's,
I think it's
what
impossible.
I think, if you guys are regarding it as such, I think you're not going to figure out what is causing this. And I think whether, yeah, I just think it needs to be a kind of, I don't know, like, say, being able to be open and honest and be okay with, you might hurt each other's feelings, but if you don't really say how you're feeling and what you want, you're never gonna fucking get it.
Yeah. And it has to be okay. Whatever that person says, yeah, what they're feeling, what they want is okay.
Yeah.
So if you really love that person, like, whatever their answer is to what they're going through has to be okay.
Yeah. I think it could be, it could literally be a multitude of things, so but if many. You always continue to try and get back to where you used to be a year ago, it's not what you need to fucking do. You need
great
to go
point.
Ahead. Like, this is a part of your journey in your relationship. It might be a part, yeah, that you totally get through, but there's, you can't try and get back to where you were before. You can only go from where you are now. And I think if both of you are trying to get back somewhere else, it's just not going to happen. Mm-hmm. Maybe it could be, I'm not saying, we're not saying that she, maybe it's not a lack of love there anymore, but maybe she's,
no,
maybe she's aroused by different things now. Maybe, well, the things that you were turned on before, she's not anymore and doesn't know how to say that, because we're trying to get back to the sex that you had last year when she was into those other things. But I think everything's going to turn out fine.
Cool. Hell yeah.
Hell yeah. Great, guys. So we're going to take a pee break so everyone can go pee. And we will be right back. You can go pee too if you want to.
This episode of Don't Blame Me is brought to you by Aptiv. Aptiv produces audio-based workouts created by certified personal trainers, available through a mobile app. Aptiv makes the highest quality training available to everyone with a carefully selected group of certified personal trainers that guide you through every workout. The trainers have a wide array of personalities, so you can even find the personal training style that motivates you the best. Plus, Aptiv's in-house music production team partners with every trainer to create music playlists that are perfectly timed to the intensity and pace of your workout. When you need that extra boost, the music keeps you going and motivated. When you're ready to slow things down, the intensity of the music dials down with you. You're able to search by difficulty, music genre, and duration so you can find a workout you love every time. I personally really like Aptiv. If you stalk me on Instagram, you might have seen that I have just recently joined a gym. And boy, oh boy, are gyms scary if you have no idea what to do. And this makes me feel like I have a personal trainer inside of my ears, because I'm playing it with my headphones. Get what I mean? Where I just stick it in my head. I'm like, oh, wow, cool. I have a trainer in my ear telling me what to do. It doesn't feel clunky. I'm not scrolling through, looking through different things, trying to look at screenshotted pictures that I found in other places. So it's really handy. It's really nice. It's wonderfully motivating. And subscriptions start at $9.99 billed monthly or $99.99 for an annual membership. But for a limited time, new members get 50% off an annual membership, which is just $49.99 for the whole year of unlimited workouts. Visit aptiv.com/blame. That's aaptiv.com/blame.
Okay, guys, we are back from our break. We've been chatting. We've been snacking on avocados.
We can't stop chatting.
We can't stop chatting.
It's pretty good. It's great.
It is. Good thing it's a podcast.
Oh, yeah. Hold on. Let me adjust a little bit.
ASMR.
The second half of this podcast is going to be about having just great chatty conversations. Okay, we don't have to do that. I kind of want to, but we won't.
No, we can go on to the next call.
Okay, Meghan. So I just got home from probably the craziest shit that has ever happened to me. So I just got home from hooking up with this guy, and please try your best, like, not to start laughing. But basically, I was giving him a blowjob. And I know spitters are quitters, but, like, I was not in the mood to swallow, okay? Like, I just, like, I can, but, like, I just wasn't down, you know? So I decided to finish him off with my hand, and I didn't realize that I was pointing his dick directly to his face. And so he ended up coming all over his face and shot straight into his mouth. So that's just a quick backstory of what just went down. But I just came home and found out that he has a girlfriend, and his girlfriend is my ex-best friend who slept with my boyfriend at the time. So should I tell her that I made her boyfriend swallow his own cum, or do I swallow my pride and be the bigger person? Because every ounce of my body wants to expose him and just ruined their relationship like she did to mine, but I know that it's not the right thing to do. So I just want a little input on the situation. Maybe it'll help somebody else with, I don't know how similar my problem can be to somebody else, but I'm sure there's someone out there that has something similar going on. But yeah, anything helps.
Wow. I also just really like the, like, in my head, just based on how she said this, where she's like, I literally have to tell you what just happened. I just, in my head, have this idea that she's still sitting in her car outside of his house. And just, this was the first call that she made was to the podcast.
There's layers on that. There's layers on layers in that story.
Oh, it is. It's dramatic. First of all, I would just like to say, I'm not, again, would never name names, but one of my guy friends, was masturbating and shot cum on his face, and it was the greatest funny. Have I shown you this?
You showed me it was your screensaver on your phone for a while.
You know who
picture?
It is.
There's a picture.
No, so
of it?
He automatically, as soon as it happened, he's like, my first thought was like, I can't believe this happened, and he goes, my second thought was, I have to show this to Meghan. This is so funny.
Wow.
Sends me the picture, and then he's like, it took 30 seconds after I said to go, what? What should I have warned? But should I not have sent this to her? And it was the funniest thing in the entire world.
That's good friend.
Come on his face.
I mean, that is
come on his face. My best friend.
Yeah, no, but still, that instinct to like, I must take a photograph.
Well, it's like when something terribly embarrassing happens to you, and you're like, but I have to show somebody, otherwise it was for nothing, and I'm just sitting in this embarrassing thing.
Yeah, I guess you just hope that friend doesn't make it the save screen on their phone.
Oh, I told him I was doing. He's like, it's okay. But I would also say, in relation to that, maybe hopefully, you being able to tell this hilarious story on a podcast will get it out of your system.
So good, it's so good. Aren't we humans are the weirdest? Like, we are the stupidest creatures. Like. I think about this all the time, that like, it's so funny that like, we walk around and wear clothes and like, say hello to each other and on pay fake idea coins for coffee. And then we go home and like slop into each other and we're just these tubes of like stuff.
Ew.
and like hot. How insane is it to get a feeling in your brain that is warm and good and like, oh, that's so good. You have to like smatter goosh.
Smatter goosh.
Like around.
Erupt.
Or in your own mouth.
Wild.
That's so funny.
Wild. So funny. Yeah, I don't know.
I mean,
I think if you're a guy, it's important to try it. just taste it.
I think I was going to say, I think I kind of love the idea. The fact that he definitely has now tasted.
Got a taste of his own medicine.
His own medicine. I would also say, yeah, no. To the part where you act, we're going to stop talking about how funny this is. I mean, probably never, but at least for now.
I think she knows.
She knows how funny it is.
It is funny. It's great. It's juicy.
But when it boils down to the advice portion, I would say, yeah, I'm going to say point blank. Don't tell this girl.
You think don't tell?
I mean, I think don't tell because I think, girl, I love you. You're great. You're wonderful. But purely based on how you've phrased this, I would love if you could listen to the episode we have with Mitchell, that's coming out after this. We talk about, female on female kind of competition when it relates to men in that situation. And a lot of times us as women, if we're fighting over a guy 99% of the time, it's much more about our hatred of the girl in the situation and the guy's just a pawn. Mm. So I don't necessarily think, again, I love you, you're great. I don't necessarily know, based on how you phrase this, if the reason why you want to tell this girl is to do her a solid or to get her back for having done this to you.
I mean, I am dubious that she didn't know that they're dating before doing this.
I guess young enough been to school. Yeah, I mean, I will say I also definitely, I've definitely like hooked up with people who I didn't know were in relationships and I should have known. So I think if you went into this with, was there an inkling? Was this kind of a revenge with this girl?
If it wasn't a revenge thing, if you truly didn't know, I actually think maybe there's an opportunity to like mend these fences and be, I mean, you like the same people.
You have that in common.
I don't know. When that happens, you got more in common than you don't.
Yeah.
And there's like,
but do you think she should tell this girl that like,
tell her,
by the way,
I just think she should reflect, like you said, about what her actual true motives are.
Yeah.
If you're just doing, 'cause you know, you want to like mess something up, you know, then don't.
That is because she said, I want to tell her that I made her boyfriend swallow his own cum.
Which is pretty funny.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. But she's doing that's it for vindictive. Revenge. Yeah,
yeah, that's vindictive. I don't think that's nice.
Yeah. And I also don't blame you, though. Like, don't blame me. I don't blame you. But I mean, I'm 100% have definitely been guilty of being a kind of person where it's a
honesty without compassion is aggression.
Mm.
And I love that.
That's very true.
I think
of
that a lot. Like,
wow.
That sometimes it's not honesty. There's no reason you need to go out of your way to say something to somebody and you know it's just going to hurt them.
Exactly. Right. It doesn't serve necessarily a purpose. I think if you guys were friends and this was something, I don't think you would have gotten yourself into the situation. But I also think when it comes to other people's relationships, we've said this before in like cheating aspects, you are young enough that chances are that they're in an open relationship is probably unlikely, but you don't always necessarily know the inner workings of everybody else's relationship and then trying to meddle by doing like the good thing. I think hopefully you got the laughs out and you got the fun reaction on the podcast. Now everyone can listen and hear how hilarious this was. And I think eventually she'll be able to figure it out on her own time. And it's also, I mean, as a girl, if I was his girlfriend, that'd be the most fucking mortifying thing ever. On to the next one.
I'm a 24-year-old recent college grad, and I just would like some advice on my relationship. I've been with my boyfriend for almost 2 years now. In a couple months, we'll have been together for 2 years. And basically my problem is, so the entire time that we've been dating, he has never told me that he loved me. When we were together for almost a year, it was his birthday, and I took a gamble and I wrote him a card, and in the card, I told him that I loved him. And he read the card and just didn't really say anything. He said, thank you, gave me a hug and kiss, and that was about it. I didn't say anything, so I didn't feel like that was the time to bring it up. But a couple of months later, the subject kind of came up, and I told him that I found the situation a little bit hurtful. And I was kind of upset about it. And basically what he told me was that he really cares about me and he's just not there yet. And he eventually will get there, but it's just not at this moment. So I let it go and I thought that was fine. But I mean, it's been almost a year since that's happened and I've still gotten nothing from him. And I just don't really know what to think about the situation because on one hand, I don't want somebody to say that to me if they don't mean it. And I don't want, I can't really argue somebody's feelings. If he doesn't feel like he doesn't, I can't fight him on that. But in that same breath, if you've been with somebody for almost 2 years and you still don't love them, why are you still with them? So it's just a really, I don't know, hard situation. I just don't really know how to handle it or what to do about it, because as more time goes on, the more upsetting this gets. That's basically it. So if you could give me any kind of advice on this, I would really appreciate it.
This is funny because I'm 24. She's 24.
She's 24?
She's 24. And she's been 24? With her boyfriend for 2 years. And I'm 24 and I've been with my boyfriend for 2 years.
Oh, yeah? I think about this a lot. I think about love a lot. The word I love. I write poems sometimes. I wrote a poem called 30 Words for Love, which is like an 11-minute long poem, which like nobody ever asked for. But it was in a book of, you know, love poems that was somebody published and asked to be part of it. And I made a video of it. And it's always moved me that people respond to it because 11-minute poem no one cares about. But the whole premise is that this phrase, this word, I love you, is the only one that we've got.
Yeah.
And it's supposed to mean so many different things. How much more useful it'd be if we had at least 30. I mean, the idea started at 17 and then I just got to 30. I just had to stop at 30. Mm-hmm. But that, you know, this thing means so much. Like we said earlier, love isn't something that can be given or taken. It's there or it's not.
Yeah.
And it tends to be there. And once it's there, I think it doesn't really go away. Yeah. Which leads back to that, one of our first calls about this difficulty with the two-year relationship and the intimacy thing. Mm-hmm. Like once love is there, it doesn't really go. Yeah. In my experience, you love somebody, it's there forever. And that can create a lot of difficulties later when you're trying to figure out what do we do with this thing. This gets into me, into like the ideas of love languages, which are very important. So my blunt answer of probably this isn't the thing, move on, be okay with it. She sounds like she's got a great like emotional place she's coming from. She doesn't impose on him. She goes like, if somebody won't say it or doesn't feel it, you can't make them feel that way. That shows a lot of maturity to me. But there is the possibility, like, I don't know anything about this guy or where he's from or what he's like, what his family was like. I have, loved ones in my family, who never say I love you. I've maybe heard them say it once ever my whole life.
To their significant others.
I'm just going to apply it to me. It's like a net relationship. And I think to a significant other too, it's my grandfather, as I'm thinking of. But he shows up every goddamn day. He worked until they made him stop working and he would provide for everybody. And I know because of his childhood where he was like basically an orphan and he was in and out of orphanages with his own mother taking him in and out because she couldn't afford the kids until she could and she'd get them out again, that he didn't put a lot of stock in the words I love you, or maybe that didn't feel safe for him, but he showed up in other ways and showed his love through his actions and his presence. But that was a hard thing for me to learn, that I love you wasn't just words, that like people can say I love you all goddamn day till they're blue in the face and they don't behave that way. So I think this magical phrase, it is poetry is my favorite thing because I think it's truly magical. You can look at a piece of paper and see some etchings and it makes you feel these things. That phrase is obviously important to you, and figuring out what that means, maybe talking to him about that would be useful. After 2 years, if I don't know what did he look like? What did his touch feel like in his tone after he read the card where you said, I love you. And he said, thank you. I'm just not there yet. That might be real for him. That might be a real thing that person comes from, their family. People go through tough stuff that like saying something like, I love you can be a very frightening. It can almost make you mad to hear it, you know, because you've been betrayed by people who have said that to you or not said it to you.
Well, because that's, I think exactly what you're saying with the difference of saying it and then acting it out. I do wonder because, I mean, I know if, again, I'm a totally different person than either of you, but if I was in a relationship with somebody and like you said in the call, I don't know why you'd be with somebody if you didn't, like for 2 years, if you didn't love them. I guess
that's what I'm saying is I think there are a million reasons you would be with
exactly.
somebody.
Exactly. And I think that there can be all of these other things, but I think when you said, you can't argue with someone's feelings in regards to him, I also think you need to apply that to you. You love him. And if he can't love you in the way that you need to be loved, then you can't argue with your feelings. And this needs to be it. It's not so much about him not loving you back. It's about him not being able to love you in the way that you need to be loved. And the love language thing, I think, fully applies to it.
Have you talked about that on the podcast?
We haven't talked about the love
language. God.
Just as a brief primer, and Google, this will set you free. It'll make every relationship better. You'll understand so much more. We tend to love people the way we want to be loved. And the key to making somebody feel loved, both for yourself and other people, is understanding how they understand love. Mm-hmm. So the five are like, there's verbal, there's acts of service, there's gifts, there's touch. I'm forgetting one.
I'll look it up.
Yeah, but basically you can kind of figure out, how do you feel loved? I know for me, touch is a big one. Mm-hmm. Like just somebody putting their hand on my back or something like that, or hugging and kissing, and physical touch is a big one. And words mean a lot to me too. And I barely even feel a gift or an act, somebody cleaning up for me or something like that.
Here's the love languages. Words of affirmation, acts of service, receiving gifts, quality time, and physical touch.
Mm. Oh, okay. Is that four or five?
Five.
Mm-hmm. We forgot quality time.
Quality time.
I think that's it. I would say what is your attachments to the words I love you, and is his lack of saying it, does that then mean in your head that he's not serious about you? And that because those words haven't been said from him, does that then mean that he doesn't want a family with you? He doesn't want to settle down with you and all that stuff. I would open that I don't know.
I think if he's saying, I don't feel that way and I'll get there. If he means that way, if he means the phrase saying I love you and that's all he means, I can see a version of that. If he means, I don't know if I love you and I'll get there after two years.
I'm wondering.
Then sorry.
And has he said it to someone else before?
Yeah.
And I think you got to be selfish at a certain point. It's been, you told him you loved him a year ago. And I think you've given him a year to feel it or not feel it. But at a certain point.
A year?
Yeah. She said it a year ago.
I'm losing sense of the... Yeah. Timeline.
She said it a year ago.
They've been together 2 years. She said it
a year ago.
A year ago, and he hasn't gotten there yet.
You waited long enough that I think if it's weighing on you this much and you called into a podcast, you're still feeling pretty affected by it, which I think is totally normal. Mm-hmm. I think that you got to give yourself a time. He doesn't need a timeline to say, I love you. You need to give yourself a timeline in which you're going to be okay with him not saying it. And then when he doesn't say it, does not make you a bad person for walking away from a relationship if that's what you need. Okay, guys, we're going on to Producer's Corner. And for anyone who might not know, Producer's Corner is where producer-director Jack Ferry picks his favorite call, or sometimes we have a caller who calls back in who can give an update on their life, or anybody who might have some words of wisdom regarding a different call.
So this isn't a callback. This is a picked call.
This is a picked call.
Yeah.
Great.
A personally picked call.
Hi, Meghan. I am super stressed out about the holidays, buying presents, traveling, going to holiday parties, seeing an extended family that I don't give a fuck about. How do I keep my sanity during this time? Thank you.
Do you keep your sanity?
I go mental, but in a different way. Like, I just love the holidays.
If you could look around, guys, I fucking love the holidays as well. But I also, honestly, this is actually a fun question.
This is, of course, a fun, I mean, man.
I was gonna say, though, the thing about the holidays I find is now that I've gotten older and I've become an adult, I now understand how different holidays are for not only every family, but every person, and what things people love about the holidays. And you watch Christmas movies and you watch anything like that, whether any sort of thing you're celebrating. I think when you grow up with something so young as a kid, it's just this excitement that you have that doesn't really like format into one specific thing. I mean, I personally am not a Christmas day presents kind of person. I feel very uncomfortable with gifts. I love
giving them, though, you know?
I like giving, but I also feel very uncomfortable watching people open the gifts that I give them.
Weird.
I feel super uncomfortable, but I love buying things for people and I love thinking about what I'm going to get people, but I feel really, really, really uncomfortable watching people because I'm also afraid if they don't like what I got them, because I know that I put a lot of like time, energy, and thought into things. And then I also get terribly uncomfortable opening presents in front of other people.
Oh, because do you feel like that they expect some performance
from
you?
Then I'm now not in the moment or even appreciating the gift. I'm focusing on how my reaction can convey how I actually feel and how I translate that real feeling to a false reaction to make it match. So then everybody else can see how I'm feeling.
God. Right.
So I spiral into like a fucking terrible hating that. So I also spend Christmas with my boyfriend's family and all of them. And so for me, that is like, it's meeting all these people and being on all the time. So I would say,
Oof, yeah,
there is no shame in feeling insane. And what I have done in this year, which I'm very proud of myself, is I'm essentially giving myself, which maybe this calls a little late for that, but I'm giving myself an extended holiday season. Mm. I'm giving myself the carefree, fucking fantastically festive, fun Los Angeles. My friends and I are here. We're watching Christmas movies. It's amazing. And then I'm going to go and experience any, and it's not knocking any person or people. I love my boyfriend's family. I think they're amazing. I'm terribly anxious around just humans in general.
Anytime you got to feel on is tough.
And I think that's no matter what, I think everyone feels that. So then I'm letting that feeling and that holiday also be another holiday that happens and it doesn't ruin the feeling of Christmas. So I extend the feeling. So it's not just, there's not so much riding on the week of Christmas. And I'm saying Christmas, but it's any holiday like that in general that has massive, like multiple day festivities.
Well, there's a reason that it happens. All of those same holidays happen at the same time.
Yeah.
It's the, what is it? The, oh my God, not the solstice, the equinox. I don't know. You know what I mean? Darkest day of the year. Yeah. Oh, winter solstice.
Yes. Yeah. Winter solstice.
It's harvest. It's winter. Mm-hmm. So we're all celebrating mm-hmm. the same time. It's the darkest time of the year. And we're all just trying to make.
It's kind of the year.
Yeah. Which is why I think we try to fill it with warmth and light and something mm-hmm. and starting something new. Self-care.
Mm-hmm.
Self-care. What a radical concept self-care is. Self-care has become a funny phrase that is thrown around, I think, by millennials and stuff like that. But truly, I feel very blessed that I get very excited to see my family, hang out with them and stuff like that. And I figured out a long time ago that certain family members are going to be certain family members. And that's just how it is.
Mm-hmm.
And again, back to this idea of attachment, letting go of the things that I can't control. And also recognizing when people try to control me that they can't, because that's not, I'm not theirs to, if they feel a certain way because of how I am. Oh, sorry. Because they've got to figure that out. Sometimes parents got to figure that out.
Mm-hmm.
But I love the holidays so much. So I feel a little sad about family don't give a fuck about. And I don't want to stress anybody out. In that time though, right? Yeah. Self-care, just keep take time to yourself. Go away from your family.
Yeah.
Go for a walk. Go see friends. If you're going back home, find friends that you actually like. Sometimes that's stressful too.
Mm-hmm.
I think the opposite is also true. If you do travel back home from somewhere else, I used to pack my schedule.
The pressure to see every fucking person.
What an idiot I mm-hmm. was. And the first year, the first year, my sister lives in Brooklyn and I have some friends in New York. But not a ton. But I remember going home for the holidays one time and I was we're going to go out to Brooklyn to visit her, my nephew. She had a baby a couple years ago, four or five years ago. And it was the first time that I was I'm not seeing anybody. Mm-hmm. I'm sitting on this couch with my nephew and some pizza every day. And it was the greatest.
Yeah.
Just kind of let that go.
I think exactly what you're saying is I think weaving in forced self-care time and not just when you need it. I think being proactive about it and then being because I'm someone who suffers from terrible anxiety, and there can be, the biggest thing that I've learned is I'm very much on the whole if I'm feeling great, I'm going to coast on feeling great and I'm not going to worry that I'm not going to feel great. But I'm also not going to be it's like a kid with a nap time. If a kid doesn't seem like they need a nap because they don't seem tired, mm-hmm. you don't fucking know until that kid's throwing a temper tantrum.
Totally.
It's the same thing if you're hungry. It's I'm not hungry. I'm not thirsty. I'm just going to wait until I'm fucking parched and I feel like I'm dying.
Right.
So I think if you can schedule into your day
mm-hmm.
a walk or anything like you're saying, some sort of thing that you know that you can take some time away that's going to you're going to feel great with. And also if you can schedule it in, because again, it's this sense of obligation that we feel to people when we're we're only here for a set period of time and there's all these things that have to get done. If you have this time that you've set aside that you're going to do this, you can fucking let the people in your life know hey, yeah, from 4 to 5, I'm busy. I'm doing this thing. So it's not you're suddenly walking out and disappointing and surprising everybody. If you can work it into your schedule and everybody else knows, you don't have to be hi, I'm scheduled from 3 to 4. There's some self-care time for me and I'm going to go take a long shower and cry about how everyone's being mean mm-hmm. to me or whatever.
And I acknowledge too, that might not be enough. Some families, some people will still guilt you and still mm-hmm. fuck with you.
Yeah.
But sorry, family.
It's far worse to not do it.
Yeah,
I would say
it's far,
you think you're going to disappoint somebody and you might disappoint someone. And someone might get mad, but it's fucking far worse than you having a full blown breakdown. I mean, I will fully admit that last year, last Christmas. I was trying. It was the first year I was with my boyfriend's family and just like with him for Christmas in general. And it was, I was trying so fucking hard to be cool girl and to just be chill with everything and fine with everything. And I don't drink. And I like, there's only so much you can handle with guy, like high school boys getting together and getting drunk or meeting all these people who you don't know, who have all these connections. And I'm the only outsider and everyone's so fucking fantastic and sweet and nice and friendly. And it made me feel like this raging bitch of the fact that being like, I need to go back to our Airbnb and just like decompress. And I felt like this asshole because no one had done anything wrong. Everyone had been beyond pleasant and beyond amazing. It was just my own sense of that. And I didn't do that. And I remember being in the car in the, I don't even know where we were going. We were in a parking lot. We were about to go meet or see somebody else. And I started having a full blown hysterical panic attack. And I finally was like, oh, this Meghan, this is what you were trying to prevent. And you kept thinking that you were being a bitch, but you know, it's far worse than him thinking that you're being a little difficult for 2 minutes. This thing right here, which is now turned into this massive ordeal.
Yeah.
And I don't think you can put it off. And I think if you can plan it as much as possible, I think it'll also make you go into every day knowing that you have this little like spot to breathe or a couple of little places to breathe and you have something to look forward to. If you're slicing vegetables with some like racist aunt being like, 15 more minutes until I'm going to go do that thing that's just for me. And then you can count down the time and you have something to look forward to. So it feels a little less smothering.
I agree.
Yeah. And don't be afraid to say no. I think the holiday season, everyone thinks it becomes
the power of no.
Yeah. I mean, oh God, no is my favorite word. But
just make it nah, you know?
Yeah, nah.
Sometimes the power of no sounds too big. Mm-hmm. It sounds too mean. Someone goes like, hey, you're going to come with us to go hiking or whatever? Because we're going to take pictures of the family and you got to wear this sweater.
I'm good. It's a little less harsh.
And I will say on the counter side for the moms out there, come on. Sometimes you can just do it for your mom. It's not a big deal. You know, you don't have to make such a big deal about it. Sometimes give your mom the goddamn photo.
I say pick your battles and then also also know that as an adult especially that you know your limits and kind of abide by them. And just because it's the month of December doesn't mean that your stress or sanity is going to has a larger threshold. Oh, we crushed it. This might be our longest episode yet, depending on when it gets edited. Yeah. I was like,
It's going to be long.
It's going to be a long one.
I'm sorry, not sorry.
No. I can listen to you talk all the time.
We were talking about this the last time we were recording, we were just scrolling through Instagram and talking about how you're so nice to listen to as a human. Yeah. I enjoy listening to you. I feel like I'm smarter when I talk to you. Like, I feel like I learn things.
I feel like you feel opening gifts. I feel like I don't know how to process that right
we
now.
I'll move on very fast.
I want you to know that it makes me feel very good.
Okay.
I'm very honored. Thank you.
We just started talking like cavemen. I am uncomfortable and
that is what happens.
Yes, the things
I do not know how to demonstrate for you that this is meaningful.
Compute the emotion word feeling thinks.
Discomfort.
Uh-huh.
A reptile brain feels like maybe I'm going to die, but I thank you.
Thank you. Okay, guys. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Where can they check you out on the internet?
Definitely Instagram-y, Jarrett Sleeper. Jarrett_Sleeper is like probably my most active thing. I would check out D20strength.com. My brothers and I started this. It's my brother's passion project, really, and I'm really happy to be like doing it with him. It's a supplement company for gamers and nerds. We've been like dorks and playing video games our whole lives, and our relationship between our physical bodies and really for everybody. Like our first product that I have right now, I really love. It's called Reboot. It's to help specifically with blue light insomnia, like staring at screens all day and then like not being able to go to sleep at night. So it's to help you go to sleep. It's got some great like, you know, valerian and magnesium and hemp extract and then beta carotene, different carotenoids for your eyes, whatever. I'm not going to go into a whole thing.
It's just
stuff that we made because it helped us out. So check that out, D20 Strength. And if you play League of Legends, which somebody out there has to play League of Legends, me and my brothers are obsessed with this game. We started this stupid project for ourselves with D20 called LOL Wands, where we do workouts based on each of the League of Legends champions. And there's like 140 of them. Mm. So it's going to take us a long time. We're doing them twice a week, but it's kind of fun and silly. So check that out. I guess that's it. D20 Strength. And Jarrett Sleeper.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great.
Awesome.
Love you guys.
Amazing.
Thank you.
Amazing. And if you guys enjoyed listening to this episode, we would love if you gave us some nice reviews on the Apple Podcast app. And if you listen to this and you were like, hey, I want to get a part of this fun action, then you guys should definitely call and leave voicemails for upcoming episodes. Again, that phone number is 310-694-0976.
Yeah.
And again, international callers, you can email voice memos to meghanpodcast@gmail.com. We would also love to get caller updates. If you guys have called in before and we've discussed your predicaments, I would love to know where things go.
I want to know how the thing goes with the guy who swallowed his own jizz.
Fuck yes.
Let us know.
So, so bad. I want to know that. There's a lot of things. There's a lot of things I want to know about. And yeah, we would love to hear from you guys. And I hope you guys have happy holidays. And we'll see you in 2 weeks.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays.
Don't Blame Me is a production by me. Produced and directed by Jack Ferry. Associate producer Melissa DeMons. Edited by Melissa DeMons. Post-production sound by Chris Henry. And music by Giacomo Picasso and Ryan Hunter. I will see you guys in 2 weeks. And don't blame me if your life bursts into flames before then.